Well, we want to thank you for joining us for this Facebook Live interview with Democratic candidate for governor of South Carolina, Marguerite Willis. Marguerite is from Greenville, South Carolina. She's lived all over the place, but she now lives in Florence. Tell us just briefly before we begin, Marguerite, why do you want to be governor?
I want to be governor, Jane, because I think it's time for a change. I am one of those folks who is tired of politicians who promise you something and don't keep their word. We have big problems here in this state, some of them involving health care, education, economic development, and I think they need a new touch, a new vision, and someone who, like me, has made a career of solving big problems on a time schedule.
Excellent. Now, of course, we're inviting all of you viewing to tap in. I say call in, write in. What do? You tap in with your questions. Marguerite would love to answer your questions in this 10-minute interview. But I'll start with some of the questions that we're asking each one of the candidates. Let's start with how will you ensure that the citizens of South Carolina have access to affordable, quality health care, something you mentioned a moment ago?
Yes. Well, health care is actually one of the governor's big responsibilities. And affordable health care is very important, particularly in our rural areas of this state. And if you're lucky enough to live in Greenville or Charleston or Columbia, you have great health care there at your fingertips. But in the rural areas, we are losing hospitals. We have folks who are not able to get to a primary care doctor. So we need to focus on those areas particularly. I would, in the rural areas, make sure that we have more nurse practitioners, that we'd as well have urgent care centers where people can have their urgent needs met and then be transported if they need surgery. We don't need surgical centers across the state, but we do need to have on-the-ground health care for those folks. Affordability, well, we need to expand Medicaid. We've talked about that before, but I think the Governor Haley made a mistake when she didn't expand Medicaid, and Governor McMaster hasn't done it either. There's no good reason not to. It's a little over $1 billion a year in additional revenue to the state, and it would cover a lot of our poor folks who need the medical help, because there's nothing more expensive than someone going to an emergency room for the flu. You need to go to an urgent care doctor, you need to go to some local practitioner to get treated for the flu and not take up the space and the cost associated with emergency room visits. So that's important to do as well. So we'll expand Medicaid and work on the rural health care areas.
Do you believe that the citizens of South Carolina enjoy gender equality, and what would you do to ensure gender equality?
Well, I don't believe that the citizens of South Carolina have gender equality. This has been a passion of mine for years. March was Women's History Month. And what we learned there was that South Carolina vetoed the 19th Amendment, which was the women's right to vote. South Carolina vetoed the ERA in the 80s. And right now, South Carolina is one of only three or four states, depending on how you count them, that don't have equal pay for equal work for women. So the first thing that I would do would be to do everything in my power to get the Equal Pay Act passed in South Carolina. It means an additional $5 billion in revenue every year for this state. And I don't see any reason why we don't have that law enacted. It's been a long time and no action from the legislature. So that's important to do. I also think that with regard to women, particularly, and economic equality, there's some other considerations that we need to look at. A lot of women are the principal breadwinners and family leaders of their families, particularly over where I live. And we need to be mindful of the fact that people want to work sometimes, but they can't. It's very hard for a woman who has a low-paying job to afford health daycare for their children. And so one of the things that we talked about is I want to extend the school day. That'll help the working moms be able to have a job and be able to build a little bit of a nest egg to take care of themselves and their families. Now, going back to equal pay, in general, the difference in what a woman is paid and a man is paid is 20 cents on the dollar. And 20 cents on the dollar is not much money, maybe, if you say I make $200,000 a year, so it's only $40,000. But if you make $40,000 a year, it takes you down to $32,000. And just think about that. It's real money. It's real money that can be used for families and for futures of families in this state.
All right, let's turn to Matt. He's got a question from a viewer.
Yeah, Kenneth asks, what are your views on the Second Amendment?
Well, the Second Amendment being the right to bear arms under our Constitution, my view is this. In the Heller decision, which is a famous Supreme Court decision, Justice Scalia, who is a very conservative justice, he's passed now, a very conservative justice, said that the Second Amendment is not unlimited. It is not an unlimited right. And so I have proposed now, in light of the school shootings and in light of what I think is common sense, I propose to ban assault weapons, to ban bump stocks, and to go to universal background checks in connection with the purchase of weapons. I also have said that we need to consider raising the purchase age for guns to 21, with the exception of certain hunting guns.
So, and now we've got a kind of a broader question to change subjects. Julie asks, what the path is for a Democrat to win in this state?
The path for a Democrat to win in this state is to get out there and knock on every door, ring every phone, speak on every corner, and tell folks that it's time for a change. It's time to treat all South Carolinians as people of dignity and quality. And the way you do that is you, in my case, focus particularly on the women. The women of this state are 52% of the citizens. We control 51% of the wealth. And I think it's time we said, look, we don't want what you have. We just want what we're entitled to. And we want to be treated, again, as people of dignity and equality. So that's one way, is to appeal to the women. The second way is to appeal, I think, to the goodness of every South Carolinian, and to say to them, we need to do better for everyone, not just the folks who have all the money, and not just the folks who don't have any money, but for everyone, for grandmothers and aunts and uncles and folks who are in nursing homes, and for our teachers, for those people who work a day job, those people who work the shift at the factory. We need to help everybody have a better life in this state.
I'll kind of summarize several questions that have all been about the Second Amendment answer now that people are hearing that one. But you mentioned raising the age to 21, but what about the age? People can already vote at 18, and they can also join the military, where they're obviously using weapons there.
Well, are you talking, I guess the question
would
is
you
the
change
differential.
The age of conscription, I suppose?
I think that there are some people who are ready to go into the military at age 18, and they will be absolutely, completely, and professionally trained to use weapons. That's the problem we have here, is that at 18, some people aren't as mature as they are at 21, and we don't have training to buy a gun. Unless you're going to have a concealed carry permit where there is training. If you're just going to buy a gun, there's no training associated with it. So that's a differential I would make there. Obviously, we all support our veterans. We all support the young men and women who go into our military service. But they'll be trained there.
Jackie wants to know what you will do about DSS, the Department of Social Services.
I was on a gubernatorial panel recently, Jackie, with regard to social service. Social service needs. And the Department of Social Services is very understaffed. We're very lacking in caseworkers. And I'll tell you this, Jackie, this is personal to me. My namesake niece, my sister's older child, was adopted from the DSS system. Our family is ever grateful to South Carolina DSS for Marguerite Elmore. Mm-hmm. Our sweetheart. And so it is personal to me to make sure that department is structured properly, is staffed properly, and the social workers are treated as real professionals, because they work a very hard and difficult day every day.
Darlene asks, what are your thoughts in regards to teacher pay?
Darlene, we pay our teachers way too little. We need to raise teacher pay in this state. There's no question about it. We're one of the poorest paying states in the nation. Just last year, we lost almost 7,000 teachers. Two reasons. One, because they're not being paid adequately, and two, because some of our schools are very difficult places to teach. And so we need to raise teacher pay, Darlene.
And then we'll get one more last one in. What about resources to help women business owners? That's from LaShawn.
Thanks, LaShawn. That's a great question. Women business owners, particularly the entrepreneurs, are the backbone of our growing economy. And I am personally interested in exploring the possibility of opening what I call a women's bank, a bank that would be state-supported, but would be a type of place where we can have women get assistance, perhaps loans, to get their businesses going and support.
Marguerite Willis, thank you. It's been wonderful to visit with you. We appreciate so much your time here. And thank you, everyone, for tuning in. And remember that you can tune in and watch, tune in on Facebook. Am I using the right terms? Tune in, of course, and watch this anytime on Facebook. Thank you for watching WIFF News 4.